Nuclear capsules. The nuclear capsule was the most significant part of the early nuclear weapons. After World War II, a major emphasis was placed on making nuclear weapons easier for the military to handle through improved methods of assembly at the storage sites and by in-flight insertion, IFI. Design changes such as the IFI had ramifications for safety as well as for improvement of performance. Nuclear testing conducted in 1948 had first introduced the concept of a removable capsule design whereby the fissile material could be inserted or removed manually from an otherwise fully assembled weapon. Subsequently, considerable attention was devoted to the development of a system for in-flight extraction. This design, used for both the Mark IV and Mark VI, has the advantage of being absolutely nuclear safe since the capsule could be inserted manually in the bomb bay while on the way to the target, or removed before landing if the mission was cancelled or aborted. It also improved reliability since the weapon could be examined on a continuous basis and shortened the time required to respond to a strike order. The 332X0 career field was established to provide military personnel for the important activities related to the maintenance of nuclear capsules in the field. The duties of the 332X0 specialist were to inspect and maintain the nuclear components of the capsule and the pit of the weapons. 332X0 training was conducted at Lowry Air Force Base. The training consisted of about 4 months of basic electricity and electronics theory, and 2 months of set school. The more technical training involved studies in nuclear theory and instruction on the inspection, maintenance, disassembly, and assembly of the initiator and nuclear capsule. At most of the Atomic Energy Commission storage sites, the nuclear capsules were stored in bank-type vaults with two combination locks. These vaults were located either in separate parts of the plant or in special buildings in the plant area. In order to enter these storage areas, two individuals had to be present at all times. Personnel would remove the bird cages from their storage compartments in the A structure and deliver them under tight security to the C structure. The C structure at the operational storage sites provided equipment and space to perform all required maintenance operations on the nuclear capsules used in several of the earlier nuclear weapon designs. Before opening the bird cage, the specialists put on protective gear. This included a rubberized apron, respirator, and latex gloves. The bird cage would be depressurized, and the top removed. A handling tool was then screwed into the base of the capsule support. The capsule was removed from the bird cage and placed on a support ring. The capsule was visually inspected and cleaned, using Kim wipes and trichloroethylene. The early weapons used polonium-beryllium initiators to generate neutrons during the implosion sequence. Polonium-210 has a half-life of approximately 138 days, so the initiators had to be replaced periodically. The radioactive initiators were stored in a basket made of brass that was suspended in the pit by a strong aircraft-type cable system. Source pit, brass basket, polyethylene cap, lead shield, and cable. After completing the inspection and cleaning, the capsule was returned to the birdcage. A bag of desiccant was then placed on top of the capsule support bracket, and the top was replaced. The birdcage was then pressurized and resealed. After the inspecting, cleaning, and testing of the capsules was completed, the capsules would then be transported back to the A structure. Between 1954 and 1957, the initiators were replaced with a new type that were sealed and did not require routine replacement. Another aspect of the 332X0's duties and responsibilities involved dealing with spalling. As the nuclear capsules aged and went through temperature cycles, they would begin to spall. Spalling was a physical reaction that resulted in small particles of plutonium popping off the surface of the capsule, sometimes as far as 2 feet. If the capsule was spalling, a transparent plastic covering with two handholds was placed over it. Even with this precaution, radioactive particles would end up on the table or floor. The cleanup of these particles was accomplished by wiping the area, or sometimes even painting the affected area. By the late 1950s, most of the capsules were enclosed in a cadmium can, and therefore did not require a complete inspection, just verification of the pressurization of the birdcage. Inspection and cleaning of the pit. Inspection and cleaning of the pit area of the weapons was done in the mechanical bay using latex gloves, a flashlight, a mirror, Kim wipes and trichloroethylene. A visual inspection was conducted first, with the flashlight and mirror by looking through the IFI, in-flight insertion, tube. The pit was then wiped down with Kim wipes and trichloroethylene. The most difficult part of this procedure was trying to reach the back part of the pit. With the Mark 6, the entire arm of the specialist was inside the pit, and the specialist's head was pressed against the high explosive sphere and a detonator. In the Mark 15, Mark 17, Mark 21, and Mark 36, it was necessary to reach through the IFI tube and clean the back of the pit using a toilet brush, wrapped with a Kim wipe. By about 1960, the nuclear capsules had been phased out of the stockpile and the requirement for maintenance activities at the sea structures was terminated. This phase-out was caused by the increased stockpiling of the sealed pit thermonuclear weapons, such as the Mark 28, the Mark 15, Mod 2, and others. Residual contamination. Contaminants generated in the maintenance process were TCE, alcohol, acetone, desiccants, lead, and uranium oxides, transuranic. In the early 1950s, it was common practice in the United States Air Force to bury radioactive waste. This was merely a reflection of the AEC policy of those times. A technical order, TO-00-110A-1, specified procedures to be followed, including identification of the burial site location on appropriate maps, and fencing to prevent entry of unauthorized personnel. Kim wipes contaminated with spalled uranium oxides, transuranic, solvents, desiccants, lead wire seals, and gloves, were wrapped in butcher paper and placed in 18-inch by 18-inch by 24-inch cardboard boxes. Records indicate that from 1952 to 1954, the cardboard boxes were sent to Albuquerque, New Mexico. From 1954 to 1959, the boxes were disposed of in shallow trenches located inside the queue areas. In 1959, the Air Force rescinded authority to bury low-level radioactive waste, LLRW, on-site, and switched to a contractor disposal system. Radioactive waste emergency holding tanks. The sea structures had floor drains that connected to an outside area that contained a 5,000-gallon underground storage tank, UST. The USTs located near the sea structures were constructed to contain any radioactive material accidentally released during maintenance of the nuclear capsules. The piping to the UST had a valve that normally directs uncontaminated washdown fluids to a storm water drain, rather than into the UST. If there had been an accident, however, the bypass valve would have been opened, to allow the collection of contaminated wash water and any radioactive material that had been released. Although these USTs were supposed to have been removed, there is substantial evidence that many of these tanks are still in place. For example, two sets of valve indicator posts were found inside the sea structure at site item. One set in each of two laboratory rooms. In the north room, the valve marked sanitary waste was open. In the south room, both valves were in the open position. The UST located near the C structure is still in place and is covered by a graded slope. It had been surrounded by a fence that has since collapsed.